Good day everyone, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. In this video, we're going to talk about some of the elements of the information systems control. The first one is the operating systems and network, and the second one is the database. Now let's start with the first one, the auditing of operating systems and network. Now why is the operating systems and network is important to the information systems control? Now let's look at the operating system. Now, operating system is basically the first line of defense against any threats to the information system of a company. Application is actually installed in the operating system. So this basically means that if you want to access the application, you need to first access the operating system, right? And secondly, operating system is the only programming code that can directly command the hardware. So this means that any hardware failure or any viruses that can threat the hardware, this means that it needs to go through the operating system first before it can affect the hardware. Other than that, of course, we know that inside hardware, which is the storage device, is where the data is actually saved. So this means that if you want to access the data through the hardware, then you have to go through the operating system first. Now, to gain access to the operating system, we have two main channels. The first one is through the physical computer itself. So when you gain access to the laptop physically or to the PC physically, this means that you might be able to gain access to the operating system. And the second one is through the network. So since nowadays every computer systems are connected to the network somehow, this means that if you want to gain access to the operating system, you can gain access to the network. So this is why the operating systems and network control are very important for the information technology control. Now, let's look at some of the threats and the controls, and as well as the audit objective and procedures. I'm not going to go through each one by one. I just want to give you an overview. What kind of threats and what kind of controls are needed to the operating systems and networks. There are basically three main threats to the operating system integrity. The first one is the accidental threat. So this threat is accidentally made. For example, there are hardware failures and of course errors in the user's application. And the second one is the intentional threat. So this threat is an intentional attempt to illegally access the data or violate privacy through the operating system. And of course, this is usually done for financial gain. Yeah. And there are other threats or growing threats that is actually not for financial gain, right? With no apparent gain, but it's actually done intentionally and unintentionally. The first one is from the privileged personnel who actually have access to the operating system. They can abuse the access by doing a lot of things to the information system, like installing a pirated version of applications in the operating system and so on. And secondly, individuals who actually browse through the operating system to identify any exploits or security flaws. So this means that this individual is the one who conducting the internal control and the audit internal, right, to the company. So he's the one who gain access if there is any flaw. And this is also a threat because he or she can actually become a threat itself, right? And the third one is the individuals who actually insert viruses or any other destructive software to the operating system itself. Now, of course, these individuals can be an employee inside the company or can also be outside threats, for example, hackers, right? Okay, so that's the threats. Now, let's look at some of the controls and the audit objectives and procedure for the control. The first one is the access control. Of course, the access privilege control. We need to make sure that the users that have privileges to access the operating system are basically controlled, right? So for example, in this case, we need to review users' permitted login time. So this means that every User who log in will be recorded, and we will review who is logging, what time is he or she access the operating system inside the office hours or accessing it outside of the office hour, why did he or she access the operating system outside the office hour, and so on, right? And the second one is, of course, the password control. Now, in order for the users to gain access to the operating system, he or she needs to log in with using a password. Now, a password control can be audited, for example, by making sure that the password itself, the policy of the password is where the password needs to be updated regularly. For example, every month you need to change your password. In a company, this is a must. If you are using a system individually, it might be too inconvenient to change your password regularly. But following the company policy, IT governance control, you need to follow the password policy. And the third one is the virus and destructive programs. So basically, you also need to control any viruses that can go to the operating systems, and it might destruct any other applications or any data or even hardware, right? Because viruses can actually destroy hardware by over abusing the hardware itself, right? And some of the controls and the procedure in this case verify that the antivirus software is updated, current, and upgraded frequently, right? And systems audit trail. So this is the types of detective control. So basically, every time you log into an operating system, it will be recorded, right? So this is where we can review the log. Yeah, we can review the logs, and we have to make sure that every login attempts are actually authorized appropriately. Yeah, so these are some of the audit processes that can be done. An example is where if you want to do exams in Alloc, the administrator can actually gain access to your log records and look into your browser's cookies. So this means that if you are trying to find answers in the internet, you are trying to browse answer by opening another tab or opening another browser, the Alloc will be able to get the data of what you are doing, right? So be careful if you do exams through the Alloc system. Okay, now next is the network. The network is where you can gain access to the operating system. So this means that the network needs also to be controlled. Some of the risks pertaining to the network is where first, for the intranet is usually safer compared to the internet because intranet is a private network and internet is the public network. However, since the intranet is inside the company, some of the threats actually came from inside of the company. For example, in this case, we have the privileged employees who can access to the intranet may allow an unauthorized access to critical data. Yeah, for example, if he or she wants to access data, but he or she is not inside the company, so he or she will give the access to the critical data to one of the employees or one of his or her subordinate, and then his or her subordinate will gain that critical data, right? Now, next is internet risk. As you can see, that internet is a public network, so this means that it possesses a lot of risk, especially since it's from the public. This means that the public can attempt to gain access to the operating systems from outside of the company. So any attacks can happen to the operating systems. So how do you control it? Of course, we have two main basic control of these attacks. The first one is building a gate, right? Building a gate means that in the information technology terms is building a firewall. So building a firewall means that you are trying to stop any unauthorized access from outside of the company. Now, even though you can build gates, however, the data that is being transmitted from a company to another company. For example, if there is a transaction using electronic data interchange, the data needs to be transmitted from one company to another company, for example, to headquarters, to the branch, or from the company to its supplier. Now, this means that we also need to secure the data that is being transmitted through the gates from the headquarters to the branch, from the headquarters bridge to the branch gate. Now, in doing so, the data that is being transmitted through the network needs to be encrypted, right? So, being encrypted means that users outside the company, which is in the public network, can still access the data, can still eavesdrop the data, but those users cannot open or cannot understand the data, right? Okay. Next, let's look at some of the controls for the network. The first one is the offer the subversive threats. Yeah. So against those attacks, we need to try to control it. For example, previously I mentioned about firewalls. So making sure that the firewalls can actually prevent any unauthorized access. That's to review it, to verify it, and to try to test whether any outsiders can gain access or can go through the firewall. Okay, other than that, previously I mentioned that to gain access to the operating system, not only through a network, but you can also try to gain access to the operating system through the physical computer system itself, which is the personal computer or server or even the laptops of users. So this means that you need to make sure that the physical access to those physical computers are also controlled, for example, like by locking any laptops that is being used by the employees, or even if you still remember the central computer access where you actually store all of your servers, mainframe, and so on, to prevent physical access from outside. This means that you also need to build a structure, a very good structure. You need to have a control over the physical access through these PCs, laptops, servers, and the other physical computer. Okay, so that's the operating system and network. Next, let's look at the auditing for database systems. Now, I'm pretty sure you already study about database systems, where there is an database elements, the entities, the attributes, and the relational relationship. For example, we have one-to-one relationship, one-to-many, many-to-many, and so on. I assume that you already learned about this in the accounting information system class. So I'm not going to dwell a lot about that. Now I'm going to look at how database administrator can control the database itself. There are basically three different kind of query languages that can be used to manage the database. The first one is the data definition language, and then the second one is the data manipulation language, and the last one is the data control language. Now, for the data definition language, we have the basically where you can create the database and the tables inside the database. So you can create tables, alter the table, or basically drop the tables. And the DML is the manipulation of the data that can be stored inside the database. So you can select, which is to view the data, and you can update, of course, to change the data. You can add or delete to insert more data or delete data. Now, DML and DDL have to make sure that there are integrity inside the relationship of the database. For example, the integrity between master file and transaction file, right? So that there will be no anomalies inside the database, yeah? And the last one is the data control language. So this is basically where you can give access, or in this case, you can grant access, or you can revoke access to the database itself, right? Now, other than these query languages that is used by the database administrator to control the database, We also have other types of control to the database. This, for example, concurrency control is where the database is make sure that the presence of the database is complete and the accurate data is at all user sites, right? So this ensures that the transactions for each of the user site are accurate, yeah, and reflected in the database of all on the other side. So basically this means that there will be no conflicts between updates. So if one function tries to update the database and the other function will try to update the database, the concurrency control will control which site can update it first based on the, for example, by using index and other types of control. So for example, user A and user B tries to update the database at the same time. So who's going to be given access to from the database first, right? So this is how to make sure that the database is controlled. And the next one is the auditing data management system. So basically there are two types of management system that can be controlled. The first one is the access control. For example, in the DCL, the data control language, we can use grant or revoke to give access to users. And the last one is the backup control, where for example, we can use redundant arrays of independent disks to control the data, making sure that the data that is updated will be backed up automatically in another part of the storage system, or even in this in the same part but on different partitions. Okay, now other than that, of course, data that is stored inside the database is the same way data that is being transmitted over the network. They are all needs to be encrypted, right? So that even though you can gain access to the database, you still cannot open the data, or you can access it, but it's encrypted. Okay, I think that's all from me, just a little bit overview. For a more detailed information in regards to these two elements, you need to read the book. Thank you very much for your attention. I'll be seeing you guys next week. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.